these problems that we have with our current way of handling food waste, just realized I can no longer be a part of this problem. I've got the skill set to do this, so why don't I solve this problem? That's what got me started, and what the solution would be, I had no clue. So I got on the journey.
And that's Jeffrey Neal, founder and CEO of Loop Closing, where we spoke about eliminating food waste completely, paying it back to the community, and taking on a problem without having a clue of what the solution might be. Up next, season one finale of Hustle and Grind.
Today we're with Jeffrey Neal with the company Loop Closing, based out of Washington, D.C. Jeffrey, tell us about your business. What does it do, and why are you so happy to be here?
Hey, thanks for having me here. I'm looking forward to talking with Joy and you. And Loop Closing, what we make it feasible for organizations to live their values, for people in those organizations who want to meet their zero waste goals around food waste. So what does that mean? We put composting machines where dumpsters once stood. And so you can compost your food waste on site. Instead of hauling it, handling it right where you generate the food waste. And then once that food waste is transformed into a food resource and made it a compost, on vehicles that once returned to the farm empty, we put the finished compost on that and take the compost back to this farm, so we close the ecological loop. And the farmers know what to do with it. They grow our crops for next year, and the food tastes even better, and so many other benefits.
Wow. So how cool. Do you even get into that business? I mean, were you someone that grew up as a kid, yeah, and when you were so, you know, you wanted to fight climate change and all of that? Like, what made you go into trash, really?
Yeah, my job was as a civil engineer corps officer was to manage our facilities. So I was around facilities, and dealing with the waste that's generated at our facilities is something we did. But we never really thought about it. We just did status quo. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until I was laid up with some injuries from service, and I was sitting on a sofa, and I had eaten a banana, and I was stuck holding the peel, and I didn't want to lay it in the sofa and get the sofa dirty or the floor. I think I was watching a sports game, and it was so boring. So I just started thinking about, well, where does this banana peel really go? Yeah. Usually I'd be frustrated. Oh, darn, I wish we could recycle it and put it, and get up and then put it in a trash can and forget about that thought. But this time I had to sit and really think about it. And the more I thought about the life journey of that banana peel, how it gets hauled, and when we haul it, we create waste and we create pollution, and air pollution is deadlier than car crashes and murders combined. Mm. And then it goes to a landfill or incinerator where we bury it or burn it and create deadly or greenhouse gas emissions, which is driving climate change. And along the way, we don't put these industrial facilities in affluent neighborhoods. We put them in underrepresented communities. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't just for the luck of the lottery room, I would be in one of those underrepresented communities and be subject to these industrial systems. So I just unraveled just all these problems that we have with our current way of handling food waste, and just realized I can no longer be a part of this problem.
Wow. I've got goosebumps.
Yeah.
Joy may have them because it's cold in the barn, but I have them because of what you're saying. Just
both,
kidding, Joy.
For both reasons.
No, Jeffrey, that is so inspiring. I mean, I know a lot of us. I mean, I moved my family to this farm. I've fallen in love with reading about regenerative farm practices. We have a compost. It's really exciting. It's our big project this year as a family. But I haven't done anything that, I'm just like so blown away that you've taken something, you saw it as a problem and decided, hey, I'm gonna find a way to do something and even make a business out of it. How do you get started doing something like this?
So a lot of people think you have to have this master plan and everything thought out. Life doesn't work that way. I completely stumbled onto this. So like I said, I got motivated. So how I got started was, I'm just going to solve it for me. I'm not going to be a part of this problem anymore. So I lived in a condo unit in DC. I had no backyard to make a composted bin or a pile like grandma and grandpa would do. Mm-hmm. And so stuck in a dense urban environment, I needed to figure out a solution. So I stumbled upon doing worm castings, feeding my food waste to worms in my condo unit. And that's how I started recycling my food waste.
Wow.
And then I realized, I started killing my worms and doing it wrong. Mm-hmm. And then so someone told me, well, take a composting class. There's this group called the Institute for Local Self-Reliance, and another group, Eco City Farm, is going to give a class to teach it. So why don't you learn how to do it right? So I went to the class, I learned how to do it right, and then they put a hook. If to get the class, you then take what you've learned and you spend 30 hours in the community sharing this information. So, okay, so I did my 30-hour community project. And while I was out with the community, I realized I wasn't alone. There's so many people in the community that also want to learn, or not necessarily learn, but want an infrastructure solution that works for diverting their food waste from the landfill and getting it back in the soil to do all the benefits it can do. And so they, in the class, we started doing community composting projects. And so a three-bin system, then we put them in containers because we're in an urban environment. It's having open piles is hard. And so we started with that. And when I did it at that level, at the community level, I thought, this is going to be a nightmare. There's going to be rats and spills and smells. And this is just such a bad idea in a dense urban environment. And whoa, was I wrong? I completely learned that I had no clue about how beneficial composting is in the city to cleaning up the city. So once I learned that lesson, that these small systems, instead of putting food waste in a dumpster or trash can where it rots, waiting to be picked up, and that attracts rats, mm-hmm. if you put it in a composting machine, it completely gets rid of the smells and the odors and the spills.
Right.
And we got rid of rat burrows. This was next to Howard University. My aunts went there in the 70s and 80s. I remember visiting. And they had legendary stories about the rats. And we got rid of the rat burrows that were in that area.
Wow.
So these light bulbs started going off. Wait, other people want this. It works in the city. Businesses started bringing their food waste to me. It was a lot of work to do with the shovels and the piles we were doing. So then we started looking at composting machines. They're already available on the market. We tested those. Those worked even better. And then I realized, wait, all these people want it. People are paying billions of dollars a year to send it to the landfill mm-hmm. and incinerators. Why don't we just divert that same money to something that will have all these benefits? And instead of being stuck at a 6% recycling rate in the U.S., we now have a path with this model to get to 100% recycling rate. And so that's how I got on this path.
I want to get in a little bit of the business, because we have young entrepreneurs that are watching this thinking, well, how does he make any money doing this?
Yeah.
Talk to us a little about that.
First, I didn't.
Yeah.
And then what I found is I just started wondering, is this feasible to do?
Mm-hmm.
And upon just figuring out the feasibility and solving all these little problems that come up along the way, people offered to start paying me.
Mm.
And this was just during the discovery period of, can I do this? Condo building wanted composting, and they gave funds to cover the cost of the equipment so I could experiment with it and figure it out. Howard University, who I spoke about, they provided some seed funding to start figuring this out as well. Knowing all this was just an idea to experiment with. And then from there, I applied for some grants. Several of them were won. Echoing Green is a fellowship I received, which helps people with social entrepreneur ideas that are trying to make a difference. And they give you 2 years of capital funding and a whole bunch of access to resources and people. So
awesome.
It's really surprising how much money is available if you have an idea where you want to make the world a better place. So don't be afraid to ask and tell people what you're doing, because I didn't know those funds were there.
Hmm.
I just told people, my friends, hey, I got this idea. I don't know how to solve this. And they would tell me, hey, well, why don't you talk to these people? Or why don't you talk to those people? So exercising your network when you start sharing what you're doing just brings stuff you didn't know was there. And a big enabler for that is we're so afraid to say what we don't know in society. There's so much shaming going on and othering going on that we always have to feel like, oh, we have the answers. We know what's going on and we're correct and we're right. Well, we need to let go of that. If you just stay curious and you just share your curiosity with people, a lot of times you're going to be sharing, well, I don't know about this. I don't know about that. I'm curious about this. Can you tell me? And if we can just stay in that space, that then lets people help you. That lets people connect with you. And it's connecting with your networks and letting them help you that we start to solve and then make headway on these big, nasty problems that we're trying to solve. Because lone wolves, trying to figure it out on your own, I'm one of those people. I'm a recovering lone wolf. Just, I'm going to do this on my own.
Yep.
I'm super independent, self-sufficient. And you're not going to get that far.
Joy and I are raising our hands right now with you.
So when you started in this field where you knew nothing about it, this was just an idea that came to you holding a banana on your couch, how did you determine, okay, I'm going to charge someone this amount to do their composting for them? Was that hard? Because I think that's something valuable entrepreneurs will want to know, because I think pricing is the hardest thing when you're starting out, even when you're established.
I'm not at the Amazon level now. I'm not when Amazon first started.
Yeah.
And so I don't have enough systems up right now where it makes the business revenue positive. And that's where the working capital comes in from these organizations and from these grants and from these funders that I'm getting to help us figure that out. Mm-hmm. So I tell them, this is what I've learned. This is what I want to learn next. And this is where I think it'll get us. And they say, hey, we think that's a good idea. We want to figure that out. Here's some funds to go figure that out. Go. Looking at the macroeconomics and seeing where we are. And that's how I've come to the pricing spot that I'm at.
One of the things that when I was talking to you earlier about our target audience, you seemed to perk up when I brought up that one of our target audiences is the underserved community. Can you talk to us a little bit about your own experience and your passion for that and as an entrepreneur yourself?
Yeah, that is a big reason why I'm doing this business. If it wasn't that focused, I probably would have left this a while ago. And it's because, looking at me, I grew up in a middle-class neighborhood, and I was very fortunate, and I basically won the lottery boom because of that. But if not for that, I would be in these underrepresented places. So it's important to me that we provide better opportunities. And what I mean by that is I incorporate that into our business model. So if we, instead of hauling away food waste to an industrial waste facility, which is put in underrepresented communities, rural communities, poor communities, typically communities of color, if we provide a model that reduces the need for that with these on-site systems, that's less harm to those communities. Another level is instead of harming these communities, we then come up with a way of hiring. Mm. So in DC, if we put one of these systems on each block, then we would have enough capacity to handle 150% of the food waste generated in DC.
Wow.
To oversee these systems on each block, if we hire enough staff to do that, that would be 200 local jobs. Well, we've created on-ramps by working with local workforce development agencies. Dreaming Out Loud is one that we're working with, that we provide training on these systems so that these members from these communities can be a part of this management team and this on-site operations team that provides this training. So it's important to provide these on-ramps so that we have an inclusive solution, so that people are not, instead of hauling and harming, we hire and heal in these communities.
Wow, I love that. And I really love what you said, hiring and healing, you know, because it's not only is your business giving back to the environmental community, but now you're finding a way to give back to the community by providing jobs, providing respectable jobs and things that people can grow from. So I really find that amazing. Well done for that. That's great.
What would you say to someone who has an idea, who sees a problem, and what would be an inspiration for them to do to take that next step?
Just take it a step at a time. Don't be focused on the end product. Don't let perfection get in the way and slow you down. Experiment, test, learn what you've learned from that, and then do the next experiment and test and learn what you learned from that. Iterate, iterate, iterate. That's the most valuable lesson. And don't lose that curiosity and just keep running with that.
I hear that.
I love it. Thank you so much, Jeffrey.
Thank
Neil,
you, Jeffrey.
With Loop Closing.
Yeah. Hey, thanks for mentioning the name because I failed to do that.
If you want to be a guest on our next show and you have a great story, check us out on thehustle.tv.
Don't forget to like us on the link below and subscribe.